QuadJacks.
There you go. How else am I supposed to clap? Yeah. QuadJacks.com, standing here with 2012 World Series of Poker main event champion Greg Merson, who just went out of the 2013 World Series of Poker main event. 161st, I want to say. That's
167.
167.
Don't give me too much credit.
That's all right. Thanks, Greg. Thanks so much. Yeah. I appreciate you taking the time to do this interview. I'm sorry you went out. You're headed out of Vegas right away?
Yeah, probably going to get on a red eye tonight. I've been on the road for basically 2 months straight, and it's time to just relax. I've taken off a decent amount of days for this 2 month trip, but still just so many long days of poker, and it was a good summer, so pretty happy about it, and time to just relax for a little bit.
I think a lot of people, they like you, they admire you, they really wanted to see you do well in this event. And at the same time, I hear sometimes the word, I heard the phrase today a lot, defending champion Greg Merson. With this event, and even with the others, it's a little difficult, it's a little unrealistic to expect any champion to even run as deep as you did. Mm-hmm. So how do you think that can be balanced, these expectations compared to the realism of large field tournament poker?
I think them using those words is good for promoting like the game, I guess, and making it, just like creating more of a buzz around the situation when they lose, the big names, the Sfondiaris, the Helmuse and stuff. So, they got to put something on TV. And, I was fortunate enough this year where a lot of those guys that take all the TV time were eliminated and put, like, the B-list guys on, like me. And, it's always cool to play on TV and for my family to be able to watch that. And it's, like... it's really cool. Like, I enjoy watching it every year. I've been watching it every year since 2003. It's pretty much the only poker I've ever watched on TV and continue to watch.
What do you think of the remaining field?
Much tougher than last year, unless I was just running bad with table draws, because my first 2 days were just amazing, amazing table draws, which is very important in this event. Last year, I think I ran really good with table draws. It's definitely a lot easier to just accumulate chips and not have to be flipping or getting all in preflop nonstop against the good players when you have softer tables. So I was really impressed with how some of these kids were playing, and it's just the evolution of the game. People are getting better, smarter, studying more, and it's going to keep becoming more and more like that each year, I would imagine.
A few days ago, you had a bit of an outburst on social media, which does happen, and I'm not one to judge because I gave you a little bit of shit as well, and I'm sorry about that. I apologized already, and I apologize again. Have there been any developments since then with the situation involving the Aria?
It's supposed to be getting taken care of, and I just want to, walk in that poker room at all until next summer. I guess maybe I'll try again, but we'll see. Like, I try to stand up for what is right by all the players, and I saw Gus Hansen make a comment about what I said, and I didn't even take offense to his comment. Everyone will have their own opinion, and he later apologized for it at the end of the interview, but it's a lot easier to say those things when you get to play. You're one of the five or six white pros that gets to play the biggest games in the world whenever you want, for the most part. He gets frozen out sometimes, but he gets to play all the time. So as an outsider, 99% of the other pros that never get to play, it's very frustrating. So, of course, those guys, and understandably so, are going to be upset when someone like myself is, bringing bringing attention to the situation. And, obviously, I wish that I would have used a better choice of words towards Jean Robert Bellande, kissing ass or something like that. But I don't regret, putting it out there. When you take eight people where we would only need one of them to start a game, and you take eight of them, we're never going to have a game ever. So... And it's not just the eight people in that big game, because I don't really care about the Ivy's Room game. I'm talking about the other game. There's two going on. As far as I'm concerned, the Ivy's Room game is private and they have a letter for that game, and like I could care less. But when another one starts on public tables outside of Ivy's room and you have, you know, 30 people on every list waiting to play the games, it affects every, like, the trickle down effect is just insane. You know, when you have, if we had access to any of those action players who would play 50-100, well, now you have all the best players playing 50-100, and now your 10-20 games are better because, like, it affects the entire market. You know what I mean? Because the games, when there's no big game, the better players play the next biggest game available, and then everyone else just keeps moving down, and then there's no action. So it really is just like a big, big, big trickle-down effect that affects the entire community. I spent 4 days there and was like, it's pretty amazing like what was going on and how no one really just like stands up for it. So I just wanted to like draw attention to the situation instead of calling the gaming commission like every other pro has done and nothing happens. And it's like I said, like as far as I know, it's being worked on, but like I just had such a bad taste in my mouth. Like maybe I'll try again next year if they have big games there. Otherwise, I'm just gonna play online cash out here, and then just like play the events that I want to play.
You said it's being taken care of by whom, do you think?
Well, I don't really want to say that, like who, but it's supposed to be getting taken care of. I haven't really heard anything from over there because it's towards the end of the series anyways, and I'm not really sure what's really been going on. Tony got a seat. It's funny, like 2 days after all this happened, Tony Greg got a seat in the 200-400 game. And I feel like they were just like throwing us a bone because they know that he's like my boy and my roommate, and that maybe that would like quiet me down or whatever. But I mean, I'm not trying to like butt heads with anyone. I've always been like a very non-confrontational person in the poker community.
Do you know if Nevada Gaming was involved or was asked to be involved and what they may have done? I thought I heard you mention Nevada Gaming earlier.
I just know that players had told me before I decided to go public with it that they had called the gaming commission and nothing had happened, or you know, they had come down and made like a visit, like whatever that means, but you know, nothing is changing. So I thought the best way to go about it was to just let everyone be aware of the situation, and it's not just me preaching to like a small community of high stakes players. It's affecting every single player from casual player to pro. I mean, if that's the room that you enjoy playing poker in during the World Series, and they have very good games there, you shouldn't be closing out customers for a select few amount of people, you know.
Since you took your stand, and I think you're the first person who at least took such a, you know, such a strong public stance against it, leaving aside the Gus interview for now, what has been the reaction in the community that you've noticed?
I mean, it's been positive from everyone except for the people that get to play the game. And the people that play the game are like, oh, you wouldn't say this if you got to play the game. Well, yeah, I think that's just like human nature, you know what I mean? If I was able to play, like, yeah, it wouldn't feel like right by any means, but I could see myself just playing and not like bringing up an issue that I don't need to bring up an issue for. That being said, I was told by several people that one of the head guys running the big games was a big fan of mine, and that I could like network through him to get into the games fairly easily. And I never once tried to just like suck up to someone just to like benefit from being friends with them to make money, which unfortunately is a big part of high stakes poker, is networking and who you're friends with and, you know, what fish you can bring to the game, or just like somehow being friends with someone for whatever reason. Like some of these guys that get to play, it's just unbelievable. Like I don't really understand like what's so great about them. There's other people that would give like more action, might not be like as good as well than like a tighter, better player. But I mean, networking is what it is. It's like part of all different forms of like work, I guess you could say.
Well, I'm sure it's if it characterizes the Aria game, it probably characterizes other games in this country and around the world. Do you think there's a solution in sight? What would you like to see happen to reverse this trend or start the process of changing it?
Well, I don't really think that that having one private game in a casino, especially for a room like Ivy's room or Bobby's room, where those, as far as I'm concerned, those tables are like private in the first place, you know, and there's not really much you can do about it, because if you let like 40 pros get on the 100, 200 and higher list, they're never going to play unless the fish comes in anyway. So it's going to be the floor calling the list, nonstop clearing it, restacking it. Like, there's really nothing you can do about that. But yeah, like I said, when a second one starts in a room that small, it's just like very, very unethical. And that's like what I was so upset about. And like the initial, like the final straw, I guess you could say, was them starting a 100-100 game when I was first on the list for 50-100. So it's just like there's so many loopholes in the system where they can change the small blind and then freeze everyone out of the game. And I sat there for 6 hours waiting to play, and then they told me I was second on the list. And I'm like, you have to be kidding me. Like, this guy you're telling me who's first on the list, I just watched him walk in the room. Like, I mean, like, especially just for the size of the game where you're not allowed to have lists higher than 50-100. They started a 100-100 game. It's just like, I mean, I come from a different generation, you know? Like, some of these older school players, like, I come from an internet generation where there's way less like cheating and scumming and like, you know, sucking up to people to then manipulate them. There's just way more like angling with live poker in general. I feel like obviously there's been cheating in online poker as well, but like the 2+2 community, I think a lot of people would agree with me, are a much more stand up group of players. Like, maybe we don't conduct ourselves at 21, 22 years old as well as we should at a live table because we're learning along the way. But at the same time, I think we've like evolved to constantly try to like improve these type of situations. Like, you know, stuff's happening online with Stars or other sites where people are seat scripting or like have these programs that probably shouldn't be legal, and like people are always trying to like make it as fair as possible. And I mean, some of the live pros are just like, it's a very, very different industry. It's very much like cutthroat, I would say.
This trend of, you know, selectively involving players at these tables, is there something that you think the community could do to stand up against it?
I mean, it's gonna take more people like myself that have like a reach to the community that are gonna like fight for what needs to be done to at least like help fix it in some way. Otherwise, nothing will ever happen, you know. If I had no following, which I had a small following before last year, obviously, I mean, what would I have been able to do about the situation? I would have kept my mouth shut, just like every other pro that's a cash game player who doesn't get any media coverage because we don't really play tournaments. Like, all these guys are very talented players, but no one really knows them. They can't really just, like, out the situation, and they'd rather take what's given to them and play once or twice a month maybe, and then just like not say anything about it. But as far as I'm concerned, I never got to play before I won the main event. I can't play after I won the main event. I'm probably never gonna get to play, and I'm not gonna keep my mouth shut to play for like 6 hours once a month. Like, you know what I mean? I'm only here for the World Series every year, and like, I was just tired of it.
Are you going to continue to campaign against it?
No, like, I'm done with it. It feels really good to like get more out there about the situation, honestly. It should be getting fixed, because I, as far as I know, like, with Tony being able to play that game, I guess that game was public. I don't really know. I haven't been over there to like monitor the situation or anything. So we'll see. I don't know. We'll see how I feel about it next year, because I'm not really like trying to like, you know, cause a scene with any like of the head people of MGM Properties, but like, I strongly disagree with what had been going on this summer.
Well, I appreciate you answering all these questions about it. So when are we going to see you in Vegas next?
NBC heads up if I get invited to play. And yeah, I think that's usually in January. So it's nice to come out here in January because it's so cold back east.
Yeah, it's cooler for sure. Yeah. Thanks so much, Greg Merson. Good luck to you. And, enjoy the rest of your year.
Thank you.
Okay. Greg Merson, QuadJacks.com.